Aye.
My voice might go completely, so I've got that stupid cough. I'm just going to jump right into it. Water. This is an actually occurring water wave called a Stokes wave. I fell in love with it at one point. Sometimes you get inspiration from something as simple as a natural phenomena caught by photograph. Turn it into clay. My dad was a potter, so I play a lot with plasticine. And then turn it into an earthwork. The first of the wave fields, as an artist, I work in series, and generally threes, five, sometimes seven in number. It allows me a chance to explore a form. Usually I'm playing with scale at that point. So the first wave field was at University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. You could sit in a wave and curl up, read a book. Third wave is at Storm King in an hour north of the city. And just to give you an idea, this was a former, it's where they, when they were building the highway, they dumped all the fill here, so it was a brownfield site. And Storm King didn't know what to do with this pit, this kind of grassed over pit. So they buried it by hiding it behind a big unsightly earth berm. So part of it is to use the site and use what's at the site. So I ended up taking the berm and turning it into the artwork. We added some new topsoil because the soil there was in such bad condition. Worked with the state EPA agency. So it's not only a 11-acre earthwork, it's a kind of a land reclamation project. So the waves in the third and final iteration go over your head. The idea was, well, what if you could get lost in a wave? So from the high side, which is facing the highway, you can look down and look over the whole field, but from the low side, you get to run through each wave. What I love is because it's a there were hidden streams throughout. Some of the rows are a little wetter, so when the state ecologists come back, they realize there's micro ecosystems growing within each wave, which I think is kind of fun. Kind of chases through the time. This is another piece. Sorry, it's like something you don't get out here, but you know, had to. It's almost fall. Though I finished up the wave fields as a series, it wasn't at all meaning that I was done with playing with the earth. This is a piece I just completed last year in New Zealand for a private sculpture park. It's called A Fold in the Field. Now, the waves in Storm King are 18 feet high. These go 60 feet high. And this is how it started. Just a simple idea. Could I take a simple abstracted fold of paper, and that's all it is, and then I tend to model it up and model it up, model it up. The last one was like 8 feet long, shipped it down there, and then we started to build it. And that's sort of how it looks, and yes, the sheep helped to mow it. And that gives you an idea of where I might be heading in a series on these folded field waves. And it too, I kind of dance between the inside works and the outside works. Obviously the outside works, though I'm very hands-on in the models, in the studies, you wouldn't entrust me to a bulldozer. I tried once, and the guy said, nah, you have to have a license, and I'm a terrible driver anyway, so don't do that. So I do connect very much to the interior works. In fact, a lot of the smaller-scaled works are the genesis for the outside works. This is called Flow. It's made out of FSC-certified 2x4s. Just, again, an iteration of the form. And it takes its genesis from a larger piece that was actually here in the traveling show Systematic Landscapes. I just called it 2x4 Landscape. What if you could bring a hill inside, allow people to climb up it, and touch the ceiling? So this is it under fabrication. It's about 3,000 square feet. It traveled for about 3 years. There were three main anchor points in the show. And this piece, from two approaches, it looked like a cresting water wave from the backside. It looked more like a land formation. So this was a form that was in between water and land. Another form was based on terrain that I know and I hike. every summer. It's my Stairmaster right outside my front door. Blue Lake Pass, and then I just cut it apart, sectioned it, and I allow you to walk through it. It's very much inspired by a John McPhee writing on just driving through a highway ridge and watching as the sedimentation had lifted and pulled and almost gone horizontal. Something that inspired me. Third anchoring piece in systematic landscapes was a water piece, and I needed a singular point island. So there's Bouvet. Most islands aren't singular points. They're mountain ridges, mountain ranges, and I just needed something to pop up. So that's called waterline, and sea level is right there, 2 feet above, and the rest is the underwater terrain, again, invisible to the human eye. Sometimes I just love using data, using technology. I see these as sort of line drawings in space, but also they're revealing things that we don't necessarily think about. Leads me to a piece that there's a maquette outside. It is the terrain above and below sea level at the mouth of the San Francisco Bay. There's Angel Island, there's Alcatraz, and it is permanently installed courtesy of the San Francisco Arts Commission at Cal Academy on the Western Terrace. And this is, again, just we start taking data sets. It took about 6 to 8 months to get the data sets, make all the drawings, translate them, and it is a permanently installed sculptural landscape that you can sit under and eat your lunch, and you're actually under the headlands as well as Alcatraz and Angel Island. But it's a drawing in space, another iteration, because oftentimes I study a form in many different materials, again, probably going back to that, the study in series. This is, again, the San Francisco Bay, and there you have it, Alcatraz and Angel Island. And these are figure ground plays, and I've been working in recycled silver, casting these major bodies of water around the world. Another way I've explored the rivers is in pins. This is installed permanently at the U.S. consulate in Beijing. It's the Yangtze River. Sometimes these rivers, though, take on a sort of shape that you wouldn't think about. And then when I was there, the consulate said, you know how many people have said that looks like a dragon? So now I can't look at the Yangtze without thinking, dragon. That's that piece. And sometimes I use the pins a lot of times with estuaries because they're all about dispersal, whereas the wax pieces are much more a very tightly understood idea of what that river system is. Just love to play between the two. And then this is where I went with a series of, again, underwater terrains. This is the tallest mountain in the world. Anyone venture a guess? Hawaii. I think it beats Everest by 100 feet or 200 feet. I'm going to have to figure that one out. But again, what we don't see, we kind of don't think about sometimes. And so maybe in my art, I'm just getting us to look at things in the natural world from a different view. Led to a series where I started cutting topographic sections. This one was for a show with Pace in New York. Here and there. The There show was in London. The Here show was only focused on New York and New York State. So I just cut a longitudinal and latitudinal section in stone, kind of circumnavigating the world. So this is the 44 degree latitude going around, intersecting with New York. New York's about right there in Danby marble. Pin River for the New York show was I took one look at the New York Times diagram of Hurricane Sandy and turned it into a pin drawing. Or the Hudson River played out in both pins, showing the estuaries and all the feeder rivers as well as in silver. The recycled silver I use comes from a company, and they not just recycle silverware, silver, it's medical imaging, it's recycling as much of the silver out of silver printing processing that they can. Sometimes I fall in love with a river just because it's an incredible, incredible form. So to me, this looked like a brainstem, and it was in the There part of the Here and There show in London, and there it is. It's the Lena Estuary in Pins. Or a series that dealt with, I had done an earlier series on bodies of water, the Caspian, the Black Sea, and this was about disappearing bodies of water. So this is the Aral Sea in 1973, and then this is what remains of it. So I took one piece of stone and we had them cut it, so all that remains of that body of water is the uppermost layer. And I did the same, I found that from 73 on, the mean low ice area of the Arctic, and turned that into a sculpture. So I'm absolutely in love with looking at the natural world, using data and scientific technology, and then returning it back. I mean, part of the reason I loved using the Vermont marble was it is so much like an almost like a stereotype of a statuary, and I just couldn't resist using this, again, very common material, like a 2x4. This just is at the parish, and I call it around the world times three. That's the latitudinal section through the Arctic Circle. That goes through New York, and this goes through the equator. Or a show that just opened in Spain at Ivory Press. It's called Rivers and Mountains. I have always wanted to play with cutting a mountaintop at like cloud line and just extracting and looking at the top of the mountain. But we also poured in a recycled glass avalanche piece, and I made one in stone, one table in stone, one in wood, recycled wood. And it's the highest mountain in the Spanish Pyrenees. I'll always try to ground you with something that's literally right under your feet. And then the wire landscape as well of the Spanish Pyrenees, Aneto Peak. And then couldn't resist. There was this beautiful courtyard that I just decided I'd pour a recycled glass piece in. I'm not going to talk about the architecture, but I can't not mention it because it is an equal part of my world. Think of my world as a bit of a tripod, the art, the architecture, and the memorials. To talk about two without the other would be kind of dishonest to who I am. I love the architecture. Right now, I'll end with just one project in the architecture section, that it's so large that I've been working on it since 2009. I keep a very small studio, and I certainly don't want the architecture to overrun the art. I wouldn't be able to work as an artist. A lot of the architecture uses recycled, reclaimed materials, as well as, this is at Alex Haley's former estate for the Children's Defense Fund. It's a chapel. Twice a year, they go to double the capacity. But everything on Alex Haley's former estate is a log cabin, single story. So I didn't want to overpower the site. So we utilize this outdoor space. It has roller furlings and gets tented over when they need it. But most of the time, it's this one simple arc shape. But I'm gonna quickly go through this and get back. So the whole building opens up so people can sit out here and look inside. Opposite it is I reclaimed an old 1870s barn and slipped a modernist skin inside. They were gonna tear it down. I fell in love with it. So it's a library and a chapel. It was so low here, and again, I love to capture outdoor space and bring it in. So it was 7 feet high here, so I put a little water table, a little fountain, just to greet you. And then you slip upstairs into the reading room. And then, as I said, the project I've been working on in Cambridge, Mass, is for Novartis. It's a medical research facility, or pharmaceutical research facility. They had the former Necco building, a very hardscape plaza. So I ended up master planning the opposite side on Mass Ave and committing them to a green space. So there'd be this urban garden here and a very green space here. And then I've taken the lead on the building right on Mass Ave. The scale had, I wanted to maintain the scale, which is about 4 stories high here. This is a historic building. It had to stay at 2 stories, and then the research facility goes up to 8 stories. that's how a rendering of it. This is a local Chelmsford stone privacy screen. Everything on Mass Ave will be given back to commercial retail. So how do you give them an entrance to their building? So here it is, this cantilevered floating entry point. So you enter the building there, or you enter the public gardens. It's open to the public during the day. The tower, it comes up from inside this wraparound stone facade. And that's this little quiet street that was so dark and in a way dangerous. So I wanted to light it with part of the building glowing. And this is sort of it under construction earlier this year. It should be done by next year. The stone scrim will go all along the back end. So everything along the street has to be more of human scale. And that's just a mock-up of the Chelmsford stone. It was quarried literally 20 minutes outside of Boston. And that's what it'll look like from down below. And it's all based on literally a microscopic view of coral. I'm not going to talk about the memorials, but yes, I do work in series. I've come back to stone a little bit, from the Vietnam to the civil rights to the women's table. I'm working on my fourth and fifth memorials simultaneously, the one in through the state of Washington and Oregon, following the trail of Lewis and Clark, but also tracing the history and ecology of the rivers. It's six parts along their journey, each one chosen to reveal aspects of ecological history, cultural history, Native American histories. I'll just briefly say that it's a lot about parking lots and picnic tables, because this is what we've turned these amazing parks into. And so I was able to get in there with the traffic study, and this is what it sort of looks like. So that, and there's a teaching history. There's pathways that lead you to the ocean, and it teaches you sort of the history of Lewis and Clark and how many villages they traveled through along their journey. But simultaneous to this accounting, which is sort of a Western idea, latitude, longitude, markers, you have the Chinook tribe, whose homeland you're in, 200 days to the day that Lewis and Clark arrived here, they dedicated the site for me, and they read a prayer, and I asked if I could inscribe the prayer in this oyster path circle trail that leads to a quiet little area. And again, a very different way of relating to nature. We call upon the earth, our planet, to teach us and show us the way. And that's that path. Ironic, this follows what the water's edge used to be before they put the jetty in. On the other side, yet another amazingly beautiful parking lot. And they were about to build another one. And this is going to come into play with what is missing, which I'll end with. We're almost there. I don't think we meant to do this. I think it just happened. I think sprawl has happened, and a lot of it has happened in our lifetime. So instead of building yet another parking lot, we had them do a transport study. And it turns out they didn't, not only did they not need another parking lot, we got rid of half of that one and turned it into a natural native grassland, wetlands. The water gets kind of catch basined and clean before it gets shunted out into the estuary. And, you know, if I'm an artist working in a park, I'm going to disappear. If I succeed, I've brought you back to where what you're there for. I don't really feel like making a big artwork. I did leave one little artwork here, because this is what their fish cutting station was like. I just love this slide. It was there at the other end of that jetty, and this is what it looks like today. And I had no idea that, again, you're in the Chinook homelands, but the myth of the Chinook creation myth is of cutting the fish the wrong way. So inscribed on the table is the creation myth of the Chinook. Another site we chose because the Forest Service was blowing the Sandy River Dam and allowing the river to take its natural course. So I created a bird blind. Inscribed within it is every single species noted by Lewis and Clark, but with a little addendum saying if that species is at risk, if it's extinct, etc. And this piece, as the forest grows back around it, it's a complete reclamation project, will bear witness to the river finding its course. And the last of these we're working on, and it'll take another 3 years to do, is I call it the Celilo Arc, and it's a bridge, not to nowhere, but a bridge to an awareness and a history that'll teach the history of one of the most important fishing places to the Native Americans of the Pacific Northwest. And it'll be a simple wooden arc based upon the fishing platforms that used to grace the river around it. More water flowed over Celilo Falls than flows over Niagara Falls, and it disappeared under the last dam to go in to on the Columbia River. So the last passage will be what the river used to sound like, and then it'll go to silence, and you'll be surrounded by this flat, still water. So those are the falls, and this is what it used to look like. It was kind of deliberately, it was deliberately buried, partly because, you know, I won't go into now, but because this was like, to them, a way to get rid of kind of the last vestiges of the fishing that was left to the Native American tribes, even though the commercial fishermen had gone out to the mouth of the bay and were just sucking up all the salmon. This was perceived as a threat to the sport fishermen. Pretty true. That photo, I can't remember when this photo was taken, but the last dam to go in was in 57 or 55, and it took, I mean, we'll be accounting exactly the number of hours it took before the falls were buried. So I started What is Missing a little while ago, but about 20 years ago, I started making clippings of endangered species, habitats disappearing. I came across an idea that what if the fifth and last of the memorials would be a memorial that would be like water? It would flow to whatever form it was invited into. It could jump form. It wouldn't exist as a singular static object or monument, but could exist in many iterations. I set up my own not-for-profit foundation. The commission that allowed me to build the wire landscape at the California Academy of Science, I actually spent less money on that because I wanted to give them an extra piece, and that extra piece is the first iteration of what is missing. This project probably got started in 2007. It's unusual in that normally when you make a work of art, you don't reveal it until it's done. This is a project that is ongoing, though I say it's my last memorial. I'll give to it probably for the rest of my life. And it's being built in full view, which is pretty dangerous maybe, because what if you change your mind and you morph it? But it's been growing, and it's been growing fairly organically. The first iteration is semi-inspired by the RCA Victor dog. It's called the Listening Cone. Kids love to sit inside, and inside is a projection screen, and we've produced over 75 1-to-2-minute films. If I had played that first intro longer, it always begins with the same intro, and then the films call out species, habitats that are missing. But we've also created something called the Empty Room Exhibit, so that's traveled to everywhere from Sweden to China to different iterations. I think it's at Nevada right now at the Nevada Art Museum. You can hold a species literally in your hands in a black box theater. We just installed 4 Cornell Anthology Labs. When I got started, Cornell Anthology Labs and John Fitzpatrick knew about this and said they basically opened their sound library to me. National Geographic also donated, the BBC donated, and a lot of other scientific groups have contributed. I figured this is going to be a pretty much a shared project. So this is a sound ring that's permanently installed with an array of speakers that Ove Arup helped design with me, and they can create basically sound landscapes through it. Creative Time and MTV Billboard lent me their billboard for the month of April a few years ago, so we created special videos for them. But this is sort of where we're at, as the film said. So, of course, it's not just the species, it's the habitats of theirs we need to protect. But it's also, for me as an artist, I'm going to reveal something that you're not thinking about. So just the scale of species, or the scale, I mean, if you look at this, the size of a cod in 1895 was larger than a man. And yet, with every generation, we forget, and we get used to a diminishing expectation of what it is. And we don't remember. So how can we protect it if we don't see it as existing? How can we protect it or restore it if we don't realize what we've lost? So in my art, I'm always trying to get you to think about things that you might not be thinking about. These are buffalo heads. And as abundant were the pronghorn, and even more abundant were the sea turtles. Like Christopher Columbus thinks he's run aground, he hasn't. He's hit a sea of turtles. So one of the things that pulls everything together, it's a little bit based on Smithson's non-sites, is the website, What is Missing. It acts as a nexus for the project. You can go online now. I am going to warn you, it is phenomenally wonky. It will get less wonky. It started with a map of the past, which marks out what we're losing, and a map of the present, where we've linked over 40 environmental groups. I'm about to collapse the time, so the dots, you'll be able to tell, certain dots will be about the past, certain will be about conservation in action, the present, and then there will be a component called green print, which is about let's envision plausible future scenarios. There are wormholes, of which I just spent the day with Malcolm Margolin, who was absolutely wonderful and contributed a beautiful wormhole of San Francisco Bay, which we've got a fragment of it here, and we're about to post it online. And you can look at each dot is either a core video or an ecological historic account or a personal memory. So I'm going to ask anyone and everyone, please participate, help build this global online memorial, share a memory, something you've personally witnessed diminish or disappear from the natural world, or tell me a story of recovery that you've seen. Because for me, I want to make this thing so we connect to it both locally and personally, as well as on a much broader global basis. You can play with it, and it's about to switch to HTML. I know I built it in Flash, silly me. But at this point in time, if you toggle view in time or view in place, you can either calibrate these stories geolocated or chronological. You can also sort, so if you just want to look at extinct species or mammals or marine, just play with it, have fun with it. It'll keep growing and improving. Right now, this is what we had of last year. There are historical quotes contributed by experts as well as by researchers, personal memories that are growing. We've linked to 40 conservation groups. We've tried to chart the most successful the environmental successes as well as our disasters, and we've also posted the videos online. These are some of the things we've found. Oysters 12 inches in diameter, lobsters 6 feet long in New York Harbor, or one of my favorite, sturgeon were so plentiful, they were nicknamed Albany beef. Or this is one of my favorites, someone entered this, just dining on the ice in Narragansett Bay, which of course hasn't formed there in quite some time. Or this is, you know, fireflies coming from someone in Korea. Malcolm, and I've just cited some, please take a read through, I'm not gonna read them. They're just beautiful and poetic because there is much about what is coming out of accounts from literature as well as early explorers, matching images that are sort of time appropriate at times, just giving us an idea of what a place was like. Not even so much to make you depressed, but make you at times just open your mouth in wonder. And I think the beauty is whenever you go into a wormhole, it's a pretty common thread. You see a degradation, and then you see recovery coming back. Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, cities beginning to recover, rivers beginning to recover. I actually think nature's pretty resilient if we give it a chance. But I wanted to just showcase this arc of change. And then there's some really beautiful personal entries. And things coming back, like in San Francisco Harbor, porpoises coming back. In New York, seals, porpoises, oysters beginning to live again. So there's hope. We've also started linking with high school kids. What a great group to begin to have them work between their history department, their art department, and their science department. And also they get to interview their parents and their grandparents. So I couldn't not have them learn more about ecological history of places. And again, I said we've linked over 40 environmental groups. I'm just basically here to celebrate the movement as a whole and try to teach the history of the environmental movement a little bit. We've also taken these timelines and exhibited them in different shows. And I'm beginning to play with motion dots, like this is just animal dot movements, which will have its iteration. What I'm working on right now, simultaneous to Greenprint, is just tracking. So we'll be taking animal sounds, animal movements, and beginning to create some sort of a more of an artwork for me out of it. A lot of what we're doing kind of disguises itself a little bit like an NGO. Of which this, here comes the NGO part of it. If the world consumed like Americans, we would need 5 planets. You could ask it differently. How many Americans could live on the planet? So Greenprint, which is where I'm at right now, and I'll probably be in it for the next year or two, will be in 4 parts. What you can do, which is actually growing online, and there are examples in here. Couldn't resist doing a save the planet diet, lose 10 tons, 10 pounds, add 10 years to your life, and save the planet too. What if, which is what I'm in right now, which is kind of the envisioning of plausible future scenarios, but at a very kind of art-oriented concept level way, and then mapping the future, which we're going to rely on experts to help re-envision true plausible future scenarios. Green Print will look at how we live, where we live, what we spend our money on. It will shrink our agricultural footprint, our urban and suburban footprint. So this is part of what F. So these are things that we're beginning to play with. What if you took the entire population, world population today, 7 billion people, and we lived at the density of Manhattan? How much space would we take up? State of Colorado. So it's really, to me, not just a question of population. Of course, it's about resource consumption and land use. And I'm, you know, 50% of us live in our major cities. By 2050, 75% of us will. So focusing in on what our cities are doing. And so we've begun to analyze cities, urban sprawl, density patterns, water consumption. We're going to be drilling down into it. I've got 2 years to figure out some basic data. But we're also playing with things like this. So according to the World Economic Forum, $700 billion annually to curb climate change. Then we just couldn't resist. Here are other things we're spending our money on. So I think part of the argument is, well, we can't quite convert to a renewable plan because, you know, oil and gas costs X cents more per kilowatt hour. And I'm sitting here going, gee, look at what we're spending our money on. Or this one, what it would take to protect and restore biodiversity, and then I just finding other examples of other things we're spending our money on. So we're making choices every day, and what we're doing is making choices for our kids and our grandkids' future. So hopefully with a sense of humor, if you just gotta giggle if you look at like restoring biodiversity or what we spend on chocolate or narcotics. And then, of course, the UN, the Global Commission just came out. We can both improve the economy and tackle climate change. No surprise to a lot of people in this room. And we also will tackle and help out and guide what each individual can do. So we start with just understanding, well, what are we doing? And what is our carbon footprint and our house size? So this is part of the what you can do. I'm sure most of you will know this because you're in California, going through one of the worst droughts ever. Largest irrigated crop grown in America? Any guess? And did you know? More gasoline is spilled refueling lawn equipment than was spilled at the Exxon Valdez. I know. So we're kind of having fun, kind of trying to put it in a different light, trying to see it all as more of a holistic picture. The amount of pesticides, fertilizer, and water that's used on the lawns, you know, this is giving half your yard back to nature. And also we'll give you pointers through like groups like the Perfect Earth Society, how to make what's left of your lawn completely eco-sustainable and, native, return it to native. Coffee, I'm going to ask you guys, obviously most of you do it here. It's the second most exported economic product after petroleum. 25 cents a cup difference between shade grown versus plantation, but look at the number of species that can inhabit a shade grown plantation. So we're always going to try to bring you back to the map, and then we'll point out the animals at risk. So the only trouble is less than 1% of the market is organic. Well, actually, the good news is that, hey, let's go for the other 99%. We play with meat. You know, we're going to end with meat somewhere. Who would have thought a rabbit is as efficient as it is? But what I didn't know is how bad a lamb is. You know, it just wouldn't have guessed that. It leads to some obvious conclusions. I won't go there, except to say, in a lot of the world, other than the West, they eat bugs. It's part of the protein. But for us, what do we do? And what do you think a free-range chicken would normally be eating? But instead, 36% of the global annual fish catch is ground up into fish meal for fish, chickens, and pigs. So again, if I can point out things we're doing, and maybe we can laugh at it and go, this is kind of silly. One of my things, just don't touch sushi-grade tuna. It is the lions of the sea. It's an incredible species, and we are basically eating it out of existence. After Japan and Spain, America is the third largest consumer of the Atlantic bluefin tuna. It doesn't stand a chance. But the good news is if we stop consuming it, these will rebound. And when they catch it, because they can't breed it, and then they farm raise it, it's worse than, I think Peter sent me a slide today. It's, you know, someone said it's like raising a cheetah and feeding it and then eating it. No. It's worse than that. It's like that which would eat the lion or the cheetah is what you're eating. It's so inefficient. And then we get to meat, 30% of the world's terrestrial land. And that's the difference in acreage required just to grow the calories for grain versus feeding the grain to a cow and then eating it. And then we'll also be looking at, and we're just beginning to start on agricultural practices. And again, vertical integrated farming is obviously where you look at the yields you can get. But you can also look at, okay, this is how we eat today. Oops. The American diet, which is very heavy on this is if the entire population ate like Americans. This is the amount of land we'd need. This is the Chinese diet, which is much less, it's protein, but it's not from cattle. And then this is more the Indian, the vegetarian diet. So we'll ask questions like, well, what if we ate 20% less meat? What if you could give back 20% of pasture land and 20% of the animal feed back to nature? It's about 660 million hectares. That is equivalent to all the protected land in North America and half in South America. It's a huge amount of acreage just by reducing our meat intake, beef intake by 20%. What I didn't know when I was told this as I was walking through the Pine Barrens, wetlands sequester 3 times as much carbon as a tropical forest, and they absorb it in the mud, in the soil. Now, as sea level rises, what's going to be at risk? So again, if I can do anything to prove that the 2-for-1 deal is the better way to go, you could protect your coastline, you could restore amazing amounts of biodiversity in our estuaries, remember, you know, Cape Disappointment, and you could take a significant bite out of climate change emissions. And then this was created by the Land Art Generator Initiative. What if you could, oh, I know, it's my only typo. It's been there for 3 years. We keep getting rid of the slide, and it's like a teasing ghost. It comes back to haunt me. I don't know why. But this is their calculations on just what it would take if we wanted to kind of balance out. And I know this is up for debate. I'll be working with one of my board members, Thomas Lovejoy, and others, because there's a lot of science going back and forth. But I'm very keen on connecting habitat protection with climate change absorption. too for. It's a simple idea, and I think we tend to think of things linearly. So if we focus just on mitigating climate change, I think we could actually make some huge detrimental decisions protecting species and habitats. But for me, if you can just combine the two, it's sort of a win-win for both. And that's sort of an underlying message and always has been for what is missing. So your homework is to go home to your computer, because it's still flash, you can't access it yet. We'll flip it over in the next few months to an HTML format, but give me a memory, something you've personally witnessed diminish or disappear from the natural world. And thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Michael. I'm the director of programs with the David Brower Center. Thank you all for coming out tonight. We're going to take about 10 minutes and do some questions with Maya. I just want to let everyone know we're filming tonight, so if you have a question, please speak into the microphone. Thank you. Anyone want to start?
We can turn the lights up.
Sam, will you bring up the lights for us?
So thank you very much. Very informative, and I didn't realize all this all these different aspects to your life. But so it just seems to me that half of the things you deal with are about beauty and doing lovely work, and then the other bits are about this incredible ugliness that's going on, and you know, all these horrible things. And so I'm just wondering, how do you start your day? Do you start thinking of the beautiful bits or the ugly bits?
I don't know. I kind of focus on the beautiful all the time. Or I'll focus on the facts. I don't know. I mean, I feel like you have to be hopeful right now because you have no choice not to be. And I think when I started What is Missing, the look on scientists' face were like, oh my God, you're making a memorial to extinct species. Please don't. It's going to be depressing. I would hope, I don't know. Did that depress you, or did it kind of give you like, chocolate, biodiversity? Like, I kind of think, well, come on, we could just go without chocolate. Not that I couldn't go, you know, I should probably choose something else. But I when you look at the numbers, we could fix this tomorrow. That's all I can do. And I don't know. I don't.
When you see a parking lot, you see something that can be
fixed. Absolutely, I'm a fixer. I think I'm an optimist in the end. How's that? I mean, nature really is resilient. We just are not giving it a moment's break. That's what I find astounding, that we literally are. And I mean, that's why what I'm doing at Confluence is so important, because it's like you can get them to do transit studies, and they didn't really mean to put that parking lot right in front of one of the most valuable estuaries in this country and then throw up a 9-foot hedge. It just happens. But my attitude is we can make it unhappen. Sorry. Another question?
That was beautiful. Thank you, Maya. I was wondering what one of the roots of the problem is desire and cultivation of desire, of artificial desires. So what do you see can be most effective in stemming that in ourselves as well as in others?
Well, I assume by desire you mean consumption. So you're too young to remember the Bic pen. When the Bic pen was first sold, it was sold with refillable cartridges. Because you couldn't get people to buy something that they would throw away. This isn't about desire. This is probably, is there are so many scientists that are studying the natural world, there are probably more scientists out there studying human behavior to get you to buy something. That's all this is about. And so the bigger question is, we've really created this incredible cycle of buy and throw out, buy and throw out. There was a very funny dark comedy called How to Get Ahead in Advertising. I don't know how many. And it's like, it talks about the dark side of the cell. And the trouble is, yes, we've grown our economy to be built on that. So you couldn't just stop it overnight and you'd crash us. But then can we ask the economists, what would it take to kind of go back to a much more sustainable, healthier way of consuming? And if you look at European consumption standards, that's why it's really important to go around the world and look at best case scenarios and worst case scenarios. And yes, we are having a very big party, but it doesn't make us any happier, because in a weird way, what you're doing is buying into the whole cycle of buying. The psychology of the cell is you want more, and then it's not enough, and then you go buy something else, and it's not enough, and you go buy something else. It's gluttony. And that's what we're in, whether it's sugar or how many pairs of T-shirts do we need, or how many, you know what I mean? And we didn't used to have an economy based on that. You couldn't stop it overnight, but I'm sure we could, because we're actually probably less happy, like the woman who did the story of stuff. She talks about it. But yeah, there's like mountains of scientists just sitting there getting you to go into the store and, you know, buy it on this shelf, not that shelf. It's all there. But we're beginning to be exceedingly aware of it. Anyway, does that answer your question?
Up in the top.
Someone's up there. I can't see.
Hi, you probably can't see me. But so obviously for this project, what makes it so powerful, or what will make it so powerful, is the website. Because it has a really nice user interface and all of that. So how has the advancement of web development and computing made this project and perhaps others of your projects?
Well, I mean, powerful? I think for me, the website is still very experimental. I know it's out there. When I say it's wonky, I'm warning you right now. Please go to it. It's so dense. It was so much. People would stay on it for like 7 minutes, 8 minutes when I had just posted the videos. And then we put this entire ecological history, and it keeps on growing. And it's like, not the attention span. My belief is the website right now is quick and it's funny. But what I love about the capacity of the internet is it has incredible depth, and it has that fourth dimension. It has time. So there I go. Most of the works deal with time. And I think we can really, you can go down, I call it a wormhole. You can go down a rabbit hole. You can go into the past, and then you'll come out in the future, and it'll be a different future. So for me, I don't know. I feel like I haven't gotten there yet, but it's, the potential is immense to make something that's both very compact yet almost infinite. And once we set up the construct, like, I love the fact that, like, Malcolm was able to give us and be the lead contributor on San Francisco, and the goal is to get more like-minded people like that who've really fallen in love with sort of connecting to a certain place and sharing it, but also having high school kids research their own backyard and interviewing their grandparents. That is, so I think there's a lot of capacity for what the web can become. Chances are it's not going to get like 5 million hits. It's like, I think it's, that's a lot, that's a whole different thing. But I think we can go pretty deep and yet still hopefully capture a little bit of the poetry of what this is about. Though, if you want to delve deeper, it'll be there.
Well, I would like to just simply compliment you for the incredible aesthetic beauty that you bring to. I would like to compliment you for just the incredible aesthetic beauty and touch that you bring to all of your work.
Thank you.
Thanks. I didn't notice in the exhibition if you included advertising in the budgets. I didn't see it, and I hadn't gone back to really look at it deeply, but I was wondering if you did, because that's a quite incredible amount of money that's being spent. And I wondered if you considered how you will get people to change, because information will not do it.
We have plans for that, but I won't go into them now. Wanted to focus on tangible things we buy, whereas your general person is not buying the advertising. That's the next leg, which is getting into what if we subsidize good practices rather than bad. It looks into the amount of money spent in R&D as a percentage of GDP when oil and gas got started, and compared to what we're spending on solar. It will focus in exactly on advertising. Advertising's a harder one to get. You can get it for US stats. It's very hard to get it globally. So it's gonna, I've got another year or two in it, but it'll get there. But generally what I wanted to do with the What You Can Do section is link what we buy in our everyday lives, link it to a place like palm oil, the orangutan, so that you know that when you buy a processed food product and it is palm oil, I'm gonna bring you to the face of the orangutan. Because that's the connection we're not quite making. It's just this box on a shelf. And so I'm hopefully making you kind of go into it a little bit. But yeah, we'll get to the advertising. It's huge because we have to get the message out there. But again, this is a guerrilla art project. I'm building it pretty much, I wouldn't say solo. I've got like some great freelancers and consultants. But it is, I'm an artist. I work in a very small studio, and I like it that way. And so, I started this in 2007. I think in another 2 years, green print will be fleshed out, and then the joy will be to get it out there and let people begin to give an end add to it. And yes, I have faith that it'll get out there. But I'm still building it. Like for the first year or two, when it was just about what we were losing, I was actually hesitant to really talk that much about it because I didn't want people to assume it's about what we're losing. Because for me, it's always been, and maybe all the memorials have always been teaching tools, that they're there to accurately remember the facts of the past, frankly, so we can think about, is it worth it? Is that the price we want to pay? So they're always about how do the memorials teach us a history accurately and remember that history so we can change course, maybe. So missing's not any different from any of the others.
Hi. I really appreciate you put a lot of effort to protect our environment. But I'm wondering that since you made many solid memorials in the past, so what inspired you to change from make solid memorial to this online memorial?
Well, in a funny way, it's an iteration. If you think about the Vietnam Memorial, it's a funny, funny thing. When I was building it, the architect of record kept arguing with me because I insisted that the stone be as thin as I could get it. And he kept going, well, it's a veneer. It looks cheap. You should make it monumental. It's like I had no intention of making it monumental because I didn't see it as a form-inserted heavy stone into the earth. I saw it as a geode. You cut the earth, you polish it. The object of the Vietnam Memorial are the names. I've been dematerializing the monument since the very beginning. Confluence, I'm actually taking the passage of Lewis and Clark and pulling it out into real time. Well, how do we know Lewis and Clark? We know them from books. So I'm pulling that book out and teaching that story along a multi-sided path. So it's all been evolving, but I would say they're all in their own way pretty quiet, sort of anti-monumental works. They're very personal, they're very intimate works, and I don't think this is any different, but maybe it is. What I love to do is rethink what something is. So I think missing ultimately really rethinks what a monument is, and it almost dematerializes completely.
Thank you.
pharmaceuticals have a pretty big impact on pretty big carbon footprint. How do you reunite building the headquarters for Novartis with what is missing?
Well, it's a good question. And I think my attitude is I probably wouldn't work for a cigarette company and I wouldn't work for a meat packing company, but though one could argue that the pharmaceutical company is both good and bad at times, we use drugs. And I won't go into it, but I actually had to use some with my mother last year. So I think the reality is I'd be more inclined to say, hey, antibiotics have to come out of all our raising of animals, but I'm certainly not going to say that we don't use medicines. I mean, there are far other corporations like ExxonMobil spending hellacious amounts of money advertising that they're green, while at the same time lobbying, like all the other oil and gas companies, to do business as usual. So I'd probably have a much harder time with that.
Would you please discuss how environmental concerns and consumables affect the design and execution of your artworks?
Say it again.
Can you explain how considerations of environment and consuming materials from the natural world affect how you design?
Well, most of the materials are recycled. Most are, except for the recycled toys for the asteroid that Richard Mizrak spoke of, are all pretty much inert. Glass is the only one that's kind of manufactured, but I only use recycled glass. The silver's, again, recycled. And generally, we're making them, and with the earthworks, they tend to be sites that are fairly in bad use or disrepair. So they too are restoration sites.
I see a lot of your work is about highlighting linkages and making people aware of things that they wouldn't otherwise be aware of, which then can change people's habits about what they do or what they choose to do. And I was really interested to find out how all the different media that you work in, I mean, from architecture and the monuments, I see a linkage, obviously, in all that work, and yet it takes you into so many different worlds. I mean, when you're engaging with a client on an architectural project, it's a very different thing than engaging with a community on, you know, reclaiming a landscape, and just what that's like for you in terms of navigating the different worlds.
There are basically two different worlds, the design world, which is basically what you would call a functional art, and then the fine art, which is really what you're doing for yourself. I think art making is a fairly selfish act in its own way. To me, one could argue it's actually harder to go into the room and do whatever you want to do. Sometimes it's easier to design a space for someone else. I've said it over and over again, but I kind of believe in it. For me, the making of an artwork is like writing a poem, and the making of architecture is like writing a novel. They're both very hard. They tap into very, very different creative sides. In fact, though the argument now is there is no left side, right side of the brain thinking, but I do believe that they kind of tap into different fields. And the memorials are kind of way in between. They're very functional, but it's sort of a very conceptual functionalism.
Great. That's a great spot to wrap up. Maya, thank you so much for joining
us. You're welcome.